LTE is set to become the driver for the delivery of service that mobile has been envisioning for years. With the legacy networks not being able to provide the best experience to the customers, both economically and in terms of quality of service, LTE has emerged out as a possible solution for providing the envisioned services. The discussion would be focused on how the operators are planning to monetize LTE, handling voice and device developments, and LTE's dependency on killer apps. The discussion also emphasizes on the go-to-market strategies of the operators to promote the uptake, the spectrum issues and requirements, and the role LTE will play in providing a unique, unmatched experience. On this note, we have the topic for our first panel discussion, Spawning New Business Models, an LTE Catalyst to an Unseasoned Data World.
To channelize and moderate the discussion, we have with us as the moderator, Mr. Satya N. Gupta, Chief Corporate Affairs, Sterlite Technologies. I request, sir, to kindly take his seat on the stage. Mr. Gupta is an international expert in NGN technologies, regulation, interconnection, and broadband policy, having 33 years of experience in all aspects of telecom. He has authored Everything Over IP, All You Want to Know About NGN, and Bandwidth Factory, Last Mile as a Managed Service. Sir worked as Principal Advisor with Telecom Regulatory Authority of India at the level of Additional Secretary to the Government of India, and headed the Fixed Network Division, including Interconnection, Intelligent Networks, IPLC, ILDO, and NLDO. For the last 1.5 years, he has worked as Chief of Corporate Affairs with Sterlite Technologies Limited for the ambitious project of FTTH, creating Bandwidth Factory in the country to provide last mile as a managed service. Presently, sir is engaged in mentoring SAM Corp Advisors, a boutique LLP managing government affairs service. We welcome you, sir, to Communicate 13.
Next, we would like to call upon the panel, Mr. V. Ramaswamy, SVP, Vodafone. Mr. Ramaswamy heads technology strategy and architecture function for Vodafone in India. His role encompasses network and IT, covering the enterprise and consumer businesses. His key role is to outline long-term strategies, select the right investment themes, adopt new technologies, and architect all the technology developments. Prior to joining Vodafone, sir was heading the telecom managed services, business, and delivery in Wipro. Sir has also worked with AT&T Solutions as a project manager and Crompton Greaves in the telecom R&D and networking divisions. We welcome you, sir, to SITM.
I would now like to call upon Mr. Murthy Bhamidi, 3G WCC Director, Alcatel-Lucent. Mr. Murthy is currently the director in the wireless division of Alcatel-Lucent and also supports an R&D team in the creation of 3G wireless radio access network elements. Sir started his professional career at Tata Steel Jamshedpur and subsequently joined CMC Limited, where he led a team of systems, software, and hardware professionals in the successful execution of complex real-time process control projects for an integrated steel plant. As a systems architect, sir helped in the realization of various business systems in the areas of finance, energy, retail, transport, and networking for clients in the US. Mr. Murthy subsequently joined Lucent Technologies R&D team at Naperville, Illinois, USA. At Lucent, he contributed to TDMA, CDMA, and UMTS wireless products creation. His areas of interest include architecture and design of mission-critical systems with focus on high capacity, performance, availability, and reliability. We welcome you, sir, to SITM. Our next esteemed panelist is Mr. Chandan Kumar Das, Country Representative, Spirit DSP and VideoMost. For the last 26 years, sir had been holding profit center and country general management responsibilities in reputed MNCs like Cisco, Aviate Networks, Telsema, British Telecom, ICO Global, Iridium, Philips and Crompton Greaves, in telecom equipment, telecom service provider, and the IT industry in India and South Asia. At present, he's working as the country representative of Spirit DSP and VideoMost in Mumbai, promoting Team Spirit Voice and Video over IP Engine and VideoMost web video conferencing software solution to telecom carriers, system integrators, enterprise government, software ODMs, OEMs, and OTT service providers in India and South Asia. Sir, SITM welcomes you to Communicate 13.
We would now like to call upon Mr. Rakesh Vij, Vice President, Business Head, Wireless and Convergence, Arisint. Sir is a seasoned business leader in telecom space, currently responsible for over 100 plus million of P&L responsibility as North America Business Unit Head in Arisint. Sir has built this business at Arisint from a couple of million dollars to over $100 million in a span of 5 years. He's also been one of the founding members of the business unit, which is over 2,000 employees. Sir started major initiatives within the business unit, including Femtocell, LTE, IMS, which helped Arisint to be a leading player in these areas in the global market. Sir, SITM welcomes you to Communicate 13.
Our next distinguished panelist is Mr. Sandeep Agarwal, Senior Vice President, Engineering R&D Services, Happiest Minds. Sir has about 20 years of industry experience covering a broad portfolio in telecom communications, enterprise networking, and storage domains. Prior to joining Happiest Minds, Mr. Sandeep has been in Mindtree for over 12 years and has been part of the core team to grow product engineering services, businesses of Mindtree in global market. Sir is a recipient of Mindtree's prestigious Chairman's Award and Citizen Award. Apart from technical contributions, Sir is a core member of Words of Peace, global non-profit organization to support and spread message of peace. We welcome you, Sir, to SITM.
Our final panelist is Ms. Kritika Venkatakrishnan, Associate Director, Axis Risk Consulting. Ma'am is a chartered accountant with over 12 years of experience in risk management and revenue enhancement and assurance services. At present, ma'am is the Assistant Vice President with Axis Risk Consulting, leading telecom assignments across various clients. Prior to joining Axis, ma'am was with Bharti Airtel, where she has worked on various process improvement projects and helped in designing the revenue risk management framework. Ma'am has also worked with BPL Mobile for 3 years in the internal audit and management assurance functions. Ma'am, SITM welcomes you to Communicate 13. I would request our moderator, Mr. Satyayan Gupta, to kindly initiate the discussion.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's indeed a great pleasure and privilege for me to be back to SITM after about 5 years. It's really a great honor also. And since morning, when I'm listening to the presentations and keynotes, and especially the one made by the students, the Provisio, that was really remarkable, actually. And I got an impression, and that is from my personal experience, that you know it more than us as far as LT is concerned. Though I'm not undermining the expertise of my colleagues here, it is a very powerful panel and it represents the whole ecosystem about LT. But your students actually have done a great job in this document, actually. So I will like to congratulate them, and we'll like to, in fact, instead of taking more time, though I think we are left with about 52 minutes only, and so we will like to give them more time to interact with us and also to ask questions if they have any from these expert gathering. So what we have decided is that the total ecosystem of LT, of course, and the background has already been given by the students. We will discuss the five major issues of the LT, and we'll start with what is called need for an ecosystem for data explosion for next 5 years, and that is where the role of LT will become very clear. And as you know, as far as data explosion is concerned, the LT alone will not be sufficient. So there are a lot of alternatives to LT, like people talk about small cell, HetNet, data offload, and even fiber to the home, because ultimate aim is how to reach the high-speed broadband to the consumer. So a lot of technologies and networks have to play a role. So we'll be debating that with two of our experts. And then the service innovation and applications of LT, because there have been a doubt about the killer application of LT. And in India, they always say the data alone does not make a business case. So what are the killer applications of LT, and whether the business case is ripe for LT in Indian scenario, that will also be discussed. And then the real business case, as well as the monetizing LT, how to monetize the LT itself. And most important part will be the regulatory spectrum and backhaul issues, actually. LT, as you know, long-term evolution. It is basically access part of it. It's not the end-to-end communication or end-to-end broadband connection. It is only the access. And access alone is not enough, though that is the last mile. That is the most important part of any network, last mile. But that alone is not enough. The backhaul, which was not very important when you talk of voice for data, and especially when you talk of high-speed data. Like here, when we talk of LT, we are talking of 100 Mbps in the handset, at the handheld level, 100 Mbps. So if that is the case of the access, each individual customer likely to be given 100 Mbps. So what happens to the backhaul? Earlier, if it is a voice-alone network, 100 Mbps was more than sufficient as backhaul. But here, one customer has to be delivered 100 Mbps. So what happens to the backhaul? What is required for that? So we'll try to discuss that. And then the LT deployment scenario in India. One expert is missing, of course, but we will take care of that. And we'll see how we are in India now and what is the way forward. So with that, I'd like to invite Mr. Murthy to say a few words on the need for ecosystem for data explosion.
Thank you, Satya. Good afternoon, everybody. As Satya mentioned, we were all quite impressed by the cutting-edge work that students here are doing. Really, really impressed. So we are trying to see whether we can match your caliber. Okay. I come from Alcatel-Lucent, which is home to Bell Labs. The Bell Labs has a modeling team which basically has projected that in next 5 years, the mobile broadband would roughly, the demand for mobile broadband will grow by 30 times, let's say 30x. So I just want to quickly, in 2 minutes, want to put down how we think this 30x demand can be met in the next 5 years. Okay. Essentially, I'll touch upon three elements. The first element is obviously more spectrum. Give more spectrum to the LTE providers, let them reform whatever is already there. This particular element will give a roughly 2x demand, will meet 2x demand. So the next one is, now we have the spectrum, now we got to get maximum out of it, which is increasing the spectral efficiency. So there are technologies like MIMO, we can have antenna technologies, intelligent antenna technologies, they could be the coordinated multi-point technologies, and similarly trying to take more spectrum and converge them and get more capacity. So all these spectral efficiency gains can get us another 1.5x. But as you see, these things aren't taking us anywhere close to 30x that we need to get to. The last one, but the biggest one, is essentially spatial efficiency. We want to increase the spatial efficiency, and that's where comes the small cells. The small cells could be a 3G, 4G small cell, could be Wi-Fi, could be distributed antenna systems. So all these together will give us that last 10x, which will take us to this 30x. So this is what the prognosis is. And the small cells, basically, the good thing about them is They give us capacity where we need it. We don't need capacity everywhere. In fact, just 10% of the locations are parts will consume almost 90% of the capacity. So good thing about small cells is we can go put it there, and a metro small cell is actually can give 10 times more capacity than a macro, and it's probably a 40% less total cost of operations. So I will ask Rakesh to take over on the small cell side. Thank you.
So before I start on the technology aspect, one thing I really loved was your campus. So guys, make the most of it during your 2 years stay here. It was really amazing. The view, the overall environment is really fabulous. So LTE, let me start with defining LTE and what actually we'll gain. So LTE is, as Mr. Gupta defined, as per 3GPP standard, stands for long-term evolution. It will give us 300 Mbps of downlink data and 75 Mbps of uplink data. And if you go to advanced LTE, it will go up to 1 gigabytes of data. It's an all IP network. Supposed to be simpler so that multiple equipment from multiple vendors can interoperate with each other, but with a very complex radio. Across the world, it is going to be one system, unlike as of now, where Asia and Europe, you have GSM, and in US, where you had CDMA. So pan across the world, eventually, I think it's going to be one system, LTE, which will rule. So is it a fat pipe? Is that the differentiator? But why do you need a fat pipe? The fat pipe is there because you can access applications. And you need faster access because the behavior pattern of people are changing. If I have to look at something, I pick up my laptop and do a Google. My son actually picks up a smartphone and does a Google. So that's the behavior pattern which is changing. The first iPad I bought was only Wi-Fi. I wanted to save $100. He wants a Wi-Fi with a 3G capability as well. So that's a behavior pattern. It's a show-off symbol, plus he wants to use it everywhere. So that's pretty much about LTE and why pretty much it will rule us. One of the important factors about LTE propagation would be small cell. So small cell provides indoor coverage to Murthy mentioned, to take care of coverage and capacity problems. If you remember a year back in Noida, suddenly because of regulatory norms, all telecom towers were shut off. So for 2 days, you had no mobile coverage. If you had a small cell in your home, you would be covered with coverage pretty much throughout. And that too, you're saving on real estate and maintenance problems because it's in your house, so you power it on as long as you need it. It's pretty much akin to a Wi-Fi access point which you have in a home. There are various variants of small cell, like the femto, which is pretty much used in the residential coverage and more in the 3G. In LTE, you have more of enterprise cells or enterprise small cells, which are used in hotspots like airports and shopping malls and so on. It's an excellent offloading solution. And offloading, as you can see, because of this high throughput and each one accessing more and more network, more and more internet, the networks are going to get choked. The only way to expand is by offloading data not to the telecom networks, but to networks adjunct to it. And small cell is an excellent example of offloading that data. In 3G, you have femtocells, which is a kind of small cell, more in the residential side, while in case of LTE, you have more usage of that on the enterprise side.
Thank you, Rakesh ji. Now we will go to the second topic, and that is the service innovation and applications of LTE. I'll request Mr. Chandan Das, our expert in this field, to say a few words on this.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for inviting me and putting me in this distinguished company of our panelists. I think we started quite well, broadly defining the LTE. And because sometime back, probably 3 years back, I was part of the team in Telsima to provide WiMAX system in India, 16D fixed OMX system. And I remember that we had to go to customers trying to defend the OMX technology, 16D and 16E vis-a-vis LTE, And of course, OMX is a foregone conclusion now. So LTE is the talk of the day. So I'll start with some data points, like the kind of internet usage that is going on now. And that is, these typical data points are basically, let's say, between 10-year-old and the 70-year-old, 10 to 70-year-old, if they're using internet services now. Right now, that population is about 922 million. And it is going up to about 1,300 by 2030, okay? And we have about 150 TV households, and about 90 million we have broadband households, And in terms of that potential internet customers, we'll have about 350 to 400 million by 2015. So then you can imagine the kind of, technologies that which will provide this kind of internet service in India. And with this giving, there are multiple varieties of internet services, broadband services are available right now. And in this, let's say drama, these LTE operators, they'll have to survive, They have to come up with a profitable business model. And as you know, as a management graduate, profit will come from the revenue and the cost perspective, right? So if we define the cost in terms of LTE, then it will be, of course, the spectrum cost, then infra cost, then it will come with the device cost, and the cost of the production, cost of producing per GB, per gigabyte, okay? And on the revenue side, of course, it will come from that number of users, which will depend on the kind of coverage that LTE operators will provide, kind of demand, the kind of applications you will have. And on top of that, you will have to have this early mover advantage for the operator to become profitable. And then the third factor, of course, will come the RPU. That, of course, will come from the capacity model, the kind of capacity you'll be building. So given these facts and assuming that like small cell technology, then that theoretical limit of 300 Mbps, uplink and downlink of 75 Mbps, all these are achieved. That's a fat pipe we have built up, okay? But what kind of applications, will fill up this fat pipe, And all of us know, like from my, 8-year-old kid, he likes to go to YouTube, He likes to see those serials, That has become a major headache for me, actually, okay? And that too over wireless, correct? So then we need to fill up this capacity, fill up this fat pipe, and that is where all the operators globally, they're finding a lot of issues. For example, AT&T, the moment they declared monthly fee for the 3G network, it got filled up in no time, okay? And then they had to, of course, use that fair usage policy and all this. So in this drama then, we find that LTE as an access, technology, and there is no voice application, no proven voice application at the moment, okay? So in the, because LTE does not have that circuit switch technology piece in this. So in terms of VoLTE, voice over LTE, so what is happening nowadays is actually a lot of trials are going on around the world, and there are very few models are available. You can take those models just pre-90s, probably mid-90s when you started on GSM service. So like Korea, Samsung, LG, they have provided to the Korea Telecom, LG U+, So these are available only for that particular technology band, a spectrum band, and for those operators. So it is not universally available. So all over the world, operators are finding a lot of difficulty in, once they are able to build up the pipe, how to fill up the pipe with the clear applications. And that is where, a lot of technologies are being talked about. One of course, is, circuit switch fallback on the 3G or 2G, But then the problem comes is still it is able to give only the voice service, not the video piece, So in this, since I come from the background of Esprit DSP, what we have got is we have got an intermediate solution, and that is what we are trying to provide to all the operators around the globe, and it is getting successfully tested also. We are building up what is called the soft client based on, high definition voice and video engine, RCS client we are building up. So this will work on any mobile phones, smartphones. It will work in a hotspot, 3G or Wi-Fi, or if it has got a LTE modem also, it will work on that, okay? So this is the intermediate stage right now. And then, of course, that native voice BOLT client, that will, of course, take a lot of time, not less than 2 to 4 years, you know. So this is the starting point, but I think this is the start of the game, and we don't have to worry about it because technology will definitely evolve, and pipe will be filled up. With this, I would like to hand over to Murthy.
Thank you, Chandan Saab. Mr. Murthy, you want to add something, or we go to the next session?
Just one point I want to add. I'll brief it. Professor Sunil Patil in the morning actually did a challenge to the teams here, okay, to be relevant. So I just wanted to categorize the services that applications, killer applications that we provide, they all will fall under two categories. One is the ones which are getting money, entertainment related, high bandwidth, low latency, entertainment kind of stuff, which meets the desires of the few. And the second bunch falls into which meets the needs of the vast majority of the people. So those applications, unfortunately, today they are not at making money, but there's a bunch of them. I just want to throw some ideas to you, and you are the people who have to make them real. Now, that bunch is basically like, for example, if you take patient monitoring remotely, it applies to everybody, okay? Similarly, farming, if you want to control irrigation remotely, if you want to, say, take things like in the security space, in the, for example, traffic, coordinated traffic, it bothers us every day, okay? There are really spaces, these are blue ocean spaces where there's tremendous opportunity. This essentially falls into machine-to-machine communication, and there are, the projection is there'll be 50 billion machines like that which will be ready to be connected, and that's where the LTE has a tremendous scope. It gives you a little ARP. ARPU is low, it's like $3 per machine, but you can get 50% margin. So there's a big space which no one is touching yet. I will want to leave it to you. Go investigate, see how we can not only make money, but also help the vast majority of the masses. Thank you.
Thank you, Murthy sir. Now we'll go to the most important part, and that is the monetizing LT, basically the where is the money, the business case part of this, for which we'll request Mr. Sandeep Agarwal from Happiest Minds.
Thank you, sir. What I want to do is basically, instead of talking about LT and telecom, actually I think you guys are experts. You are in the telecom management, so I'm sure you guys know much better day-to-day research, and last 2 years you have been doing that. So I'll just throw some recent examples that has been happening to give you a perspective about a business case, and also throw in a seed in each one of you to look at much more possible business cases that could be possible and killer applications that could be possible, just because this technology is going to come into existence, and we all know that this is going to change the way we are going to be connected in this particular world. So let me take the first example. The first example is how the Verizon Wireless is operating out of US, right? The business model that Verizon Wireless has kind of put in table is basically when they launched the LTE, the spectrum was bought by Verizon Wireless and also the LTE equipment, which basically becomes the biggest capex for any service provider. And they actually opened up a consortium kind of organization wherein they invited tier 2 and tier 3 carriers to be part of that particular stuff, especially who wants to be servicing in the rural areas. So basically the intention was that as they capitalize and make their money back with the premium customers of the urban areas, they wanted the rural areas to also go. And because the tier 3 providers are coming from the rural areas and they don't have a major capex, the business model in which the connectivity was getting established to the rural areas was very in needs for the rural. It was not actually a kind of streamed down version from an urban area. So 20 carriers have kind of registered for that particular stuff, and basically now they are getting a much more benefit because the coverage is increasing. Every rural is getting connected. At the same time, rural is getting what they need in terms of that. So that's kind of one business model, and it's more than competition. It's a co-opt model that is getting into existence from a service provider point of view. So you can think on that lines. The second important aspect that is happening is if you have heard about Motorola launching their LTE-based public safety system. So this is, again, another initiative of Motorola. And if you guys have tracked Motorola over the years, the two-way radios and the walkie-talkies is what Motorola is famous for. And it's where the communication kind of started and was actually in a private communication, in a private controlled environment, this used to be given. But that company is changing it because now LTE is opening up this particular possibility in terms of giving new kinds of innovation, not having to carry two different devices. You should carry your mobile device. Everybody carries it. You don't want to carry another two-way radio. Not only that, the control centers and the command centers that is now getting existing, it's not only for different departments. It's not something different for fire department. It's not something different for police. It's not something different for the medical sector and stuff like that. It's getting centralized from a command center point of view. So this kind of innovation is driving because of the new technologies that is happening, which is the unified communication and the voice over LTE. And that's where the technology from old technology days in a controlled environment is now possible in a much more open environment. The third example is basically Qualcomm. Qualcomm recently tied up with Audi. It's Audi, you all know about the company. They tied up and then they announced a chip that they will be actually doing it for the automotive sector. And this particular chip is called the Gobi chip. And it basically integrates five different devices within the car. So not only your car now has a separate infotainment system that is there with you, it gives you access to the internet through LTE because it's an LTE chip, and then it connects the safety devices within the particular car. So basically it's one kind of things where if there is issue with your safety and you are watching an entertainment within the car and the kids are there and stuff like that, it kind of warns you in between rather than actually you getting sucked up into that particular stuff. And also gives you things like service when it's due and stuff like that. So it connects a larger ecosystem through that particular possibility. Again, M2M and Internet of Things is kind of making this particular possibility happening. And that's where the LTE is kind of putting. So every single situation is not a monolithic industry anymore. It's looking at how do we capitalize with the data that is getting stored.
Thank you, Sandeep ji. Now I'll request our lady colleague in the panel, Ms. Kirtika, to add to this business case.
Thank you. So basically, I think if I can borrow from what Mr. Pollack said, it's not just the customer who is not indifferent to what technology is used to deliver. Most often when the business case is made to the finance team, the CFO and the finance team are also indifferent to whether it's a 3G or it's an LTE. And if I can use a often used Tom Cruise dialogue, all they want to see is show me the money. So it's very important that, you know, the whole technology, if you want that to be, you know, popularized, there has to be money at the end of the pipe. And while, you know, all my colleagues have spoken about a couple of applications, as long as the applications don't develop at a rapid speed and you're able to project that there'll be more people coming onto that, let's consider the telecom scenario right now in India. You have a CFO who knows that he has to allocate some money for rebidding on the spectrum on 2G. You know that, you know, there's a consolidation exercise that's going to happen in the economy. You need to earmark money for that. So when there is a limited source of money which has to be earmarked to various projects, and each project is then going to be judged on the merit and the return that it will give to the company, LTE will have to do a lot of catch-up to kind of demonstrate a lot of business sense to the CFO and the wider organization that there is money at the end of the pipe. Because the argument that's going to be made is if the customer is only looking for data and we're already in 3G and he's happy with it and 3G still has a potential to grow, why invest in a technology like LTE? Can we postpone this till the ecosystem is ready? So I think the discussion has to be more around the application. The external environment will have to develop far more before you can convince the finance stream to, you know, loosen up the purse strings. So let me just hand it over back. Yeah.
Thank you, Kritika. Moving on to the next topic on regulation, spectrum, and backhaul issues for LTE, I'll request Mr. Vishwanathan from Vodafone to discuss the spectrum issues related to LTE.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'll just start off with the type of data points that we heard since morning. Sandeep, for example, said that there is going to be a 1,000x data consumption which is going to happen. He said from a 500 MB average per user per month type of a data consumption today, we are going to move to a 30 GB per user per month type of a data consumption. We also heard that we're going to have in 5 years, the mobile broadband is going to become 30x, right? Now, these are all great things that will happen at the user end. And all of us as mobile data users, mobile broadband users, would love to have all of these at one end of the spectrum. Now, people like us who are responsible for delivering this to you, let's look at what can we do to sort of manage this, right? We also heard from the colleague from Alcatel-Lucent that, no, we are not going to get more than about 10x of efficiency just by adding number of sites and so on and so forth, right? So we have to meet this 1,000x using two or three different mechanisms. Typically, they say about 10x can be met by doing additional spectrum. 10x can be met by doing additional sites, such as small cells, Wi-Fi offload, and so on and so forth. And another 10x can be met by doing efficiency, increasing the efficiency of the entire operation. Now, let's first focus on this 10x of spectrum, right? Now, on an average, India, any operator like us, works with about 10 megahertz spectrum per circle, right? To compare this with some of the advanced LTE markets, let's say the US and Korea, they operate the order of 60 to 100 megahertz per operator. You know the size of Korea. So Korea, for that size, has got 60 megahertz of spectrum to operate on LTE. Now, each carrier of LTE can go up to 20 megahertz. That means they have capability to run three layers or three different carriers of LTE, a macro carrier, a capacity carrier, and a small cell carrier. Now, in India, today we have got about 10 megahertz of spectrum approximately. When I say 10, I'm saying this specifically 10 because the people who have got LTE spectrum on 2.3 gigahertz have got 20 megahertz, but in TDD. So remember, in TDD, the transmit and the receive happens in the same spectrum, and hence, on an average, you get about 10 megahertz. So half of that is what is available one way for an uplink or a downlink. So we are talking about, in India, for the type of population, for the type of scale that we have, we're talking about working with a 10 megahertz spectrum to try and reach the type of scale of 30x and 1000x. The moment somebody says 30x, 1000x, etc., we all get our hearts stop beating for a few seconds before it comes back, because we need to meet that demand using the spectrum that's available to us, right? So one of the key important problem or challenge that we as a country would have is with respect to having sufficient amount of spectrum to manage this. Now, on top of it, unlike various other countries where we have three or four operators sharing the entire available spectrum, we at some point in time went up to 14 operators, now came down to about 9 or 10 of them. So with an such, we have lesser spectrum available. On that lesser spectrum, we have more number of people competing for the available spectrum. And the third point is people like Kritika, who are available, who say that you can't monetize this because the type of ARPU that you get is not going to justify the amount of investment that you're going to make for LTE. Please be careful about how you're going to spend. Now, is it a too gloomy situation like this? You know, I'm trying to paint a little bit of an extreme sort of a situation with respect to how it is going to look like for operators like us. What we're saying is there is enough thing that you can do with an existing 3G and other things. All right, you can do LTE. It is essential that you have to do LTE at some point in time. Probably the time has to come. But more importantly, the spectrum situation, the government has to do a lot of work to ease the spectrum situation that we have. Two, from a regulatory perspective, if you have to monetize the way that you mentioned, if Verizon went and tied up with 20 other people to go and monetize it over a large period area, a country like India, if you have to take it to the rural masses, the regulatory situation today does not permit us to go and share this resource with anybody else. So if we have to go and get a partner of us to monitor the spectrum elsewhere beyond where we have our spectrum, it's not permitted in this country. So the Verizon monetization model isn't possible in this country, right? So these are the regulatory challenges that we have. Now let me come to the third portion, which is about how do we carry all this high 1000x data that gets generated at the base station, right? For a 2G, typically a base station is connected with about 4 Mbps of backhaul bandwidth. For 3G, we are doing it at around 25 to 30 Mbps of backhaul bandwidth. Still manageable using laws of physics permit you to carry that on wireless, right? For an LTE, typically, if you're talking about 100 Mbps download speed that you want to give, and a site is made up of three sectors, so you require 300 Mbps of backhaul bandwidth. Today's laws of physics do not permit you to go beyond a certain limit. That means for a backhaul for these type of networks, I need to have fiber going to each and every station, right? This city, I do not know how many of you are aware, is one of the most fiber unfriendly cities in the world, right? It is about the Pune Municipal Corporation takes about 40 lakhs of rupees for you to lay a kilometer of fiber. Now, assuming that I need to do this 1000x and I have so many sites that I need to put up, and I do small cell the way that the colleague here was saying, every site I need to connect with fiber, you can imagine to cover entire Pune city, how many kilometers of fiber that I need to put in, and for those many kilometers of fiber, how much of rights of way charges that I need to pay the Pune Municipal Corporation, and why will Kritika sign the business case? Now, so this is the situation that we are in. We, as a country, are a little peculiar as compared to probably some of our other. So a lot of things about Korea and the United States and Japan are great about the way technology is able to take us to. But the matter of fact, with respect to the ground realities on the spectrum backhaul and the regulatory situation in this country, has certain limitations that it is posing for us to overcome before we are able to really reap the benefits of what happens with this great technology.
Thank you. Thank you, Vishwanathan. You have done a great job. But but let me add to some more things here, and let me bring out some good feature also of the regulation, actually. All is not unwell, actually, as he has projected. Like in the provisional presentation by students also, they mentioned about unified license. That is a reality now last month. So there is a unified license which actually promises to solve out all the regulatory hurdles. And most of the job is done. But yes, the missing link, what is pointed out here, is that they have not yet permitted the spectrum sharing, which is required. In addition, what more is required from regulatory front is the MVNO concept, actually, so that the infrastructure created by some operator who has a LTE spectrum and the technology or network, it can be made use of by resellers kind of people through value addition, through innovative application and all that. That is another missing link. It is required to be done. As far as the backhaul is concerned, yes, the numbers are very obvious, actually. Those kind of numbers can be supported only by the fiber. And regulator or the government from their side, they are working on what is called NOFN, National Optical Fiber Network, which promises to take fiber to each gram panchayat and then to each village. And at least 100 Mbps will be there in each gram panchayat. But that also will not be enough as a backhaul of the LT, if we say so. So there is another concept which we talk like fiber to the home. There is a concept of fiber to the node, actually, or now we have started calling it fiber to the tower. So there are companies, and especially the independent infrastructure provider like Radius, Starlight, and few more, who are actually ready to invest in what we call middle mile here. The middle mile is basically fiber to the node. It does not take the fiber to the home. It takes it to the tower.
And from tower, the wireless takes over, whether it is LTE or Wi-Fi. So those kind of technologies, as well as proposals and business cases, are there. So we have to hope that these things become reality. And now I think we have come to the most important part of this debate, and that is the interaction by the participants, and with we will also
Mr.
like
Gupta, yes, one comment.
Yes, know, please.
And I'm just continuing on the Mira Bharat Mahan theme here. So, you know, the example where my colleague from Happiest Mind gave on Motorola Public Safety, the entire core network is actually developed in our labs in Arisen here in India. So if you come to Gurgaon, the entire core network which Motorola is deploying in public safety networks in US is actually developed by Arisen. Another great example on LTE, and this I'm talking about 4.5 years back when the LTE standards were being evolved. The base station, the E-Node B, as is referred in LTE, which was deployed in Docomo's network in Japan, and that was the second and the biggest commercial deployment of LTE was developed in Arisen. So those are positives as well. I know a lot of government regulations we have to work on, but I'm sure we'll work our way out as the demand increases.
Related to the regulation. On the ecosystem, I think we did not speak much about the ecosystem as a panel. When 2G was done, you know, there was a CDMA and a GSM difference. And in GSM, we had two standard frequencies, 900 megahertz and 1800 megahertz. Practically every phone in the world which had capability to support GSM used to support that. When it came to 3G, more or less world over, we had a common frequency support. On 2100 megahertz and 900 megahertz, practically every phone supported. When it comes to LTE, one of the things which LTE tries to make it good is you don't get too much bogged down about the frequency in which you operate. That's great to work with. That's great with respect to the tower equipment, but when it comes to the handset, there are challenges which start coming up because the frequency ranges that we are talking about starts with 700 megahertz, goes all the way up to 2.6 gigahertz. Now, there are no, again, practically, the laws of physics do not permit you to have one radio, one filter, to sort of operate between 700 megahertz to 2.6 gigahertz at such a wide frequency range. Hence, the SKUs of equipment vendors or the handset vendors, like Apple or Samsung or Nokia and all of those people, it becomes limiting for them to come out with various models. Hence, the current situation says, till about 2017-18, you're not going to have publicly accepted LTE smartphones. So you will have a lot of dongles, you will have a lot of home gateway routers, but to get a good quality, affordable, 10,000 rupees or lesser type of a handset with LTE, it's going to be pretty challenging.
So now we'll invite the students to interact. Any comments, anything new which they know more than the panel, they are welcome. And any questions from any member of the expert panel? Yes, there is one behind there, one lady. Yeah.
Good afternoon, panelists. This is Anuradha Acharya, second year systems in finance, SITM. I want to ask you that when Asian countries are still lingering with TD-LT, what is your think tank on Videocon penetrating the LAN mobile radio, that is the LMR market of India, through FDD-LT? What was the thought process to come up with FDD rather when the EMEA and the Asian countries are thinking about TD-LT?
So, Mr. Murthy,
yeah,
I'll
take that.
Vishwanathan.
So, not all Asian countries are going into TD-LT, by the way. It's India and China who are primarily signed up for TD-LT in 2.3 gigahertz. But since Indian regulations are going to permit us to become neutral to the type of technology that we use on any frequency band, and most of the Western countries, the Americas and Europe, is focusing on 850 megahertz, 1.8 gigahertz, and 2.6 gigahertz are three key frequencies in which FDD-LTE is going to be operational. Hence, the possibility of handset ecosystem developing in FDD-LTE, LTE in 1.8 gigahertz is higher than probably TD-LTE in 2.3 gigahertz. That's the reason why probably one of our competitors is announcing that they would go ahead and do, because that's the frequency that they have, that's the spectrum that they have, and hence they want to reform that spectrum because now it's a liberalized spectrum, so to say, they are willing to try out LTE in that particular speed. And one good thing about LTE is because it starts all the way from, about 1.5 megahertz spectrum to all the way up to 20 megahertz. So they can take out a small portion of their existing 5 megahertz and then try and do a FDD LTE within that. And that's a good probably way to start for them.
I think just to add, so India and China going with TD-LTE is also because of the usage pattern. In both these countries, the downloads are going to be much more than the uploads. And that's where TD-LTE has a much superior performance compared to FDD. So it's the usage in the land which actually governs which system you want to use.
Thank you.
So next question, please. Yeah, please go ahead.
So I'm Suwarna from Systems and Finance first year. So I would like to ask, with LTE being the future technology, will this lead to the retirement of mobile WiMAX robots network?
Actually, as you know, the WiMAX is more or less already dead.
WiMAX is dead.
Already dead. But other technologies will coexist, like your 3G technologies will coexist, your Wi-Fi will. Why? WiMAX is not there. Okay, then no problem. So, any other question, please? Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Yeah. My name is Rakesh Patel, second year SITM. So, with the increase in the speed, like 300 Mbps download speed, 76 upload speed, MTM is a big scope. So, like, how much time it will get to implement in India? And if it will get implemented, what will be the revenue sharing model, like between the service providers and system integrators and all?
Who will take this question? Or can you repeat the question, please?
Like, what will be the revenue sharing model between the service providers and system integrators if we implement MTM technologies with reference to LTE technology?
I think you'll have to repeat it again for us, maybe. So it is too difficult a question, I think.
So, like, if we adopt MTM technology in India,
yes.
So how much, what will the revenue sharing model, if we with reference to LTE technology, in okay. With service providers, system integrators, and all.
Yeah, you're talking about M2M, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So let me take that. Yeah. See, on the M2M, I think the business model and who is going to make the money is still not actually clear. The M2M technology is kind of evolving right now. It's not in a matured market. Even in developed countries, people are looking at monetizing the M2M and see who is the real benefit. Because service provider being the pipe owner, and they don't want to just give the pipe as just a pipe and nothing else, but they want to monetize from the pipe that they are building it. But the other service providers, the system integrators, and like I said, from a car company, they want to create their own private network, just take the SIM cards from the operator and then operate it actually. So as this is actually maturing and the M2M takes the stage with various standards coming up and an ecosystem getting formed around that particular stuff where device companies, the box companies and the system integrators and the service providers coming hand to hand, that's where the M2M reality is going to happen.
I just wanted to add on that. It's not at mature, but some of the likely models in US that are used, not with M2M, but it can be applied, is giving a package that you can use, say, 7 devices in this package or 10 devices in the package. Now, what you exactly use it for is a different thing. So there are package deals where right now you say you can have 6 connections in the home and you give me a $100 kind of a package. So tomorrow I would envisage in your home, if you have 25 devices, okay, pay me $5 per device or a $2 or a $1 per device. Now then what do you do with that? There's an additional revenue. So there could be IMS kind of an additional services revenue, which hasn't yet established. But just providing the pipe, allowing those devices to use the cellular network, they could be a package deal, could be a business model.
And just to add, even in the regular VAS, we still have disputes between the operators and the vast content providers on how to share the revenue. And even for an M2M, the BSS systems also will have to mature and develop for you to go ahead and, you know, promise a particular package to the customer. So initially, when the BSS is not going to be developed, the operator will try and bunch it and put a flat charge because that's more easier to administer. So until the BSS and other supporting processes mature, you're going to look at a more, you know, entry type of pricing or a experimental pricing that's going to come.
Thank you. And so any other question, please? Yeah, there is one. Yeah, you please go ahead. Yeah.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. One point, sir, I just want to discuss on that point. You said a lot of ROW cost has been required putting fiber. So, and Mr. Satya have already put it across that NOFM installation has already been going on. It will going to be in near future. I hope government will allow you to share the bandwidth in that network particular. That will obviously going to reduce a lot of ROW cost. So would telcos have been interested? Kritika Madam also can put a thought on that. Interested in using that bandwidth as a available bandwidth, first thing. Second thing is, still in India, I feel so that all the telcos are not using their existing network, a coexisting network, and being sharing the networks with each other. It's not only the ROW cost. I hope you will accept the fact that it is the fiber cut cost also, which is cutting throat of all of us. Close to statistics of 365 fiber cuts per 1,000 kilometers in a year, which is means if you discuss with people in other countries, you discuss what is fiber cut. This is what do you mean by fiber cut? There's no fiber cut here. So even by close it. Economies, Asian economies, even Malaysia, like what Maxis is doing or what Time.com is doing in their LTE evolution. I mean, this is three points which I have discussed, but can club together. One thing is fiber, one thing is sharing of network, one thing is taking on the success of our nearest economies and the people who have done it successfully nearby to us, almost in the same economies what we are.
Sure, I agree with you. In fact, all the mature service providers have gone ahead and done a lot of fiber sharing, by the way. Even us, Vodafone, more than 30% of our fiber backbone is on shared fiber. So there is enough amount of sharing that happens between mature service providers within the country. So to that extent, that's a reality. And the fiber cut situation isn't that bad as what you're trying to paint, by the way. The US talks about one cut, 1,000 kilometers in a year. One cut in every 1,000 kilometers in a year. We are at around close to that, 10 cuts every 1,000 kilometers in every month. Yeah. So yeah, about 10, 12 cuts per 1,000 kilometers per month. That's where we are. You know, you're right. So it costs a lot of money to maintain fiber as well. And I wouldn't blame this, because if that doesn't happen, there is a concern with respect to our infrastructure development. Because we are, as a country, we are a little behind with respect to the infrastructure development compared to some of the developed economies. This is a necessary evil. You know, roads have to be laid, bridges have to be built, and hence fibers have to be cut. You know, and hence I think, you know, those are things which we have learned how to overcome. Fiber cuts, we have learned how to overcome. Cost also, fiber laying cost, we have learned how to overcome. ROW still remains as a bigger thing. On NOFN, we need to still wait and see what happens, what the BSNL is going to deliver to us. And currently the focus, rightfully so, is on the rural side. What we have problem is in the urban side, right? We are not very sure whether NOFN goals and an operator's goals will be met by a common ground or not. We still do not know. We are waiting. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, Vishwanathan. And of course, I can add on to this. Like, you are right, NOFN is for rural, but for urban, there are, as I mentioned, independent infrastructure providers are there who are actually doing fiber to the home, but they can as well do fiber to the node, fiber to the tower in cities. They'll be very much happy to do that, in fact. That is one of their business case element. So now I think we can have one last question before we conclude. Yeah, there is one in the center. Yes, please go ahead. The third row from top. The last questions.
Good afternoon, panel members. My name is Vishal Baremu, second year MBA, SITM. Vishwanathan sir and Ritika ma'am, they said that deployment of LE may not necessarily pose an attractive business case. But the reality is that within a few months, one of the operators is going to launch LTE services across India. So what I would like to know, are the incumbent operators thinking of it as a challenge? If they think this is a challenge, what is it that they are trying to do to, I would say, overcome this challenge?
Yeah, actually, maybe Vishwanathan, but then I'll add to that. Okay, basically, yeah, it's a challenge, but competition is always a challenge, and like the operator which you are hinting at is always come out with what they call hangama in India, and a sort of disruptive technology and disruptive business case, yes. But that is there always with new players like that, whether it is LTE or anything. And our Indian operator, at least, they are capable of handling such challenges, and there are cases for that. So we should not be worried about that. That is my personal experience. But let's hear from the operators.
Before Rishi adds, you know, sorry, and he'll give an operator or a challenger point of view. But I think India is very unique, right? So you have GSM. So GSM is still flourishing. One of my customers says is GSM is God sent mobile, it will never die, right? So you have more and more equipment being manufactured specifically for India and Africa, you know, because there is more deployment in rural and so on. You have 3G, which is there, right, in metros. There is possibility to expand. The idea is whether to wait for LTE or, you know, expand 3G. And LTE, which is launched at a virgin stage right now, very, very nascent stage, initially in a couple of operators, and then the hangama guy coming in perhaps next year. So it's a very unique market where all technologies will coexist. And believe me, you know, seven, 8 years back, we were thinking that GSM will be dead. But I'm sure 20 years later, GSM will still have a life.
Actually, honestly, there is, you know, we are all, you know, we are all happy to have a challenger operator coming into the market. You know, there are two or three things which you need to keep in mind. I mentioned about the handset ecosystem that we spoke about, right? Unlike a GSM or a 3G handset ecosystem, the TDD LTE smartphone handset ecosystem has to develop. It has a long way to go. Probably when somebody launches, probably they have one or two SKUs with which they may try to do the launch. But, you know, the freedom of using the handset is something that 3G has taught you, right? The freedom of choosing your own smartphone is something that, you know, this technology has taught you. It's very difficult for people to sort of let go of that freedom, right? That I will only buy those two SKUs of handsets that this organization is going to give it to us. No, that's something which is going to be difficult for you to look at. This is point number one. So ecosystem has a long way to go before that operation gets successful. They will eventually become successful. I'm not saying no. But it initially, and that is the time that we have for ourselves to sort of ramp up what we're doing in the 3G space and probably also add LTE to ourselves. You know, operators like us are not going to be silent in this whole thing, right? Now, the other important thing that you need to remember is the coverage density and the capacity that we have built up in all these cities has come over a period of 15 to 18 years, right? Mumbai network, for example, has been in existence for 18 years, 19 years now. Next year, the first set of licenses are expiring, right? So 19 years it has taken for us to master the art of giving the right capacity and the coverage, and the capex that has been spent over 19 years, because you are management institute students, you would know this. No, the amount of money that you require to spend for a capacity and coverage over 19 years is going to be tough for anybody with how much ever deep pockets that they have to cover within probably 3 to 4 years time at least. I'll give that credit. Maybe 5 years they will take to catch up with. And that's good enough for others to catch up as well. Right? So it is a great thing that can happen to this country. But are we ready for the challenge? Yes, we are ready for the challenge. And there are ways and means of meeting the challenge.
Yeah, thank you, Vishwanathan. I think that brings us to the end of this interactive panel, and I'll also support Vishwanathan with that. Yeah, thank you. Basically, one good thing I've come out from this panel is the killer application of LT is not there. Or that is why we don't have to worry, because the voice part does not have a threat yet. And most of our existing operators are earning their revenue from voice. So that is one good thing to the last question. Now, I'd really like to thank the organizers and all of you. And for me especially, it has been a great learning experience. And I hope my fellow panelists also have learned more than what we have given. Actually, there is a saying that university is a seat of learning. The new students bring the knowledge, and outgoing people don't take anything away. So that is what has been my experience today. So with that, I'll thank all of you for your participation, and for me to give this opportunity, I'm thankful to the organizers. Thank you. Thank you.
That was indeed an enlightening session encompassing all possible perspectives. Surely, the audience has gained deeper insights into the best available business models for the success of LTE in the unseasoned data world. We would like to thank our panel members who have joined us and would now request my colleagues to felicitate the panelists with mementos as a token of our gratitude and appreciation. We now request our panelists to kindly take their seats amongst the audience. Thank you, sir.